That was awesome.
Really rather special. And what's equally as special is having you with us today, Kev. Welcome. Just so lovely to have you emceeing for the beginning of World Jenny's Day on the live streaming.
I know, it's great, isn't it? It's do you know what? This live streaming has been very popular for the last couple of years now, because, you know, especially when the 2019, end of 2019, beginning of 2020, when we hit the pandemic, it was such a popular platform, and StreamYard became a very big popular platform for me because I started giving back. I started designing shows and producing shows and actually hosting shows. And for me, it was such a nice way of getting back to people who not necessarily could come out or wanted to go out, and they were fearing it. So this is such a great way of doing it. And you can hit the world with this. Look at you nodding away there. Yeah, it's true.
Hopefully we're crossing fingers, because this is streaming through to my LinkedIn and right. to my Twitter as well. And we're getting people to share as well to their Facebook pages and
pictures
and profiles. So, you know, but you and I know that when you set the intent, it doesn't matter what happens, because it will have the effect that it needs to have in this time, the way it's meant to be. And we're going to just go organically as much as there is structure today. I don't want to get too cerebral about today. I want to be able to move through it. And if we have oopsies, because our technical side has had a couple of oopsies, then we have it and we have a big laugh. And that's what mental health balance and wellness is all about. So wonderful. And
It's full of oopsies.
Exactly. It's when you try and be perfect that you fall apart. So I have to show you this. Look what I'm wearing.
I love that.
Yes, isn't it fabulous?
It's really lovely. That is really lovely.
So I'm really pleased about that. And if you would like to know how to get your own, then let us know. You can contact us on the World Jenny's page. Actually, it's available on there. So love you to get
well one. Actually, don't be blasé about that. Actually explain where they can get it from, because, you know, people, if they want it, where do they go, where do they click on, what do they do? Explain that, because I think that's really important.
You're absolutely right. Well, you go to worldjennysday.com and there's a shop page there, and it's there and you can order it. It's available only this year in Europe, UK and US. But next year, watch this space. We've got some amazing ideas in place. So,
okay. So before we start, I just want to say a big hello to everyone. Hello, 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 everyone who's watching, everyone who's going to be watching. Thank you so much for coming and supporting World Jenny's Day today. And the woman you're seeing that way. On my camera, it's that way, is the wonderful Janetta Barry. Now, Janetta Barry is a force of nature. If there was ever a hurricane named after Janetta, she would wipe out the entire world. She is that amazing and that strong. So Janetta, I'm going to be I've got the privilege of interviewing you and hosting the first segment of this World Jenny's Day. And I kind of wanted to kind of tap into something very important, very, very quickly, actually. And that is your story, because ultimately, anyone who comes onto a platform and wants to do something great either has some kind of a reason behind it, or a need, or a manifestation, or some kind of an idea that's either entered their head or they've gone through an experience that they need to ultimately rescue others, because that's what it's all about. It's about adversities that we take and we change into positivity. And you have gone through that, Janetta. So I kind of want you to kind of explain a little bit about what your story is. And then once you've done that, I want you to answer the question, why? Why are you doing this? So start from the beginning and then go into this. Go for it.
Okay. So the backstory is that 16 years ago, we'd been walking a quite tight walk with my daughter, Jenny. She came to me at 13. And she'd always been my difficult one of four. Squirmy from the day she was born, you know, never settled. A very sensitive soul, but at the same time, such a big personality with a smile. As she got older and hit teenagerhood, people would stop and say, "Aren't you a famous actress? A teenage actress?" And she'd go, "No, I'm Jenny Barry." You know. So she was always my difficult one. And at 13, she came to me and dropped a bombshell by saying, Mum, I'm actually, you know, I'm going to have to move the Clubhouse out of the way. I can't even concentrate with it. Hold on a
minute. Oh, have you got Clubhouse on?
Yeah, because I need to still be there in presence.
I know. Yeah, it's going. I've actually had to come off it myself because I know we were on it. I was just literally performing as you were texting me, going, "Get on the StreamYard." But I was performing on there for you. But yeah, it's quite intense as well having both at the same time.
It is. It really is. So anyway, I've hidden it. I love it, but I've hidden it, which means I can't message guys because if I leave WhatsApp here, it clicks and snorts and does all sorts of things. Anyway, so so Jenny came to me at the age of 13 and said, Mum, I've got a problem. I'm suicidal. And I have been suicidal my whole life. When I was 7, I tried to strangle myself in front of the mirror. And I didn't even know. I mean, I knew she was challenged, but not that much. And we journeyed a very rocky road. I mean, the story is unbelievable. We got her into a rehab that really handled her very badly. She ran away. I lost her in the streets of a large city for 30 hours. I didn't know where she'd gone. And she was only 13, 14 years old. And to cut a long story short, one day, after she and I had an enormous argument, I was putting safekeeping house rules into place.
Right.
After we'd had this enormous argument, she took herself off in a rage and killed herself in her bathroom. And I found her 15, 20 minutes later. So it was huge. It was unbelievable, just unbelievable. And, you know, the following months, I went to ground zero. There seems to be a bit of feedback going on here. I don't know why.
No, sounds good to me.
Okay, it's obviously my side. So over the following month, I just didn't know how to carry on because everything went to ground zero. My marriage finally came to an end. My youngest daughter, who was very angry about it all, decided to go live with her dad. We were living in a country that allowed a 12-year-old to make that decision. And it was tough. It was really, really tough. Everything, financially, I went down to ground zero. And I planned to end my life 3 times. And it wasn't until I was having to cross a road mindlessly. And in fact, there's a piece from Insight about just that. And it was only having to cross that road mindlessly that got me to realize I was halfway across, that I'd forgotten I had choice, because it felt like I was locked into this emotional prison sentence for the rest of my life. And I got to the other side and stepped onto the pavement and went, oh, this is quite prophetic. It's like I've crossed over the road. It's my crossing over moment. I safely crossed over because it's so mindless to get hit by a car. And I crossed over into a new decision. And
wow. Okay.
And then I started going from there. So what happened after that?
I then had to even come back on that. I'll be honest with you. It's like you've gone to hell and back more times than the devil himself. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah, no, it was huge, and I really didn't know how to survive that. I on the surface, I was telling everybody I'll find a way, but I didn't really think I would. And it wasn't until I realized I couldn't take another minute of being like this. Not one minute, no more. It's not an option. That I started researching and studying and walking the walk to get myself through this. And having got to a point where I knew I was managing it, I was then able to start helping others. And haven't looked back. I've been working with people for 14 years now through terrorist attacks, through people self-harming in bed, not eating, not washing. They're all, now pilot. So yeah, it's been an amazing story.
Wow. Do you know what, it's amazing that you've gone through that, and I know where the epiphany came from for the whole, you know, Jenny's day, but how long after your experience did you decide, okay, I need to step up, I need to do this? And I think people would be very interested to hear what actually lifted you back up again.
Okay. Yeah. The process that I studied and researched and worked myself and walked the walk and talk on, I call the epiphany process. So there's the epiphany. And it's so accurate. I was determined it couldn't be one of these processes where you try it and then the next time it doesn't work.
Right.
It had to be scientifically accurate. And I call it the yin and yang of science. And then a couple of years after Jen died, we realized she died on World Mental Health Day.
It was like, right. Oh, really? I know you. Which is ironic.
It is. And I know you walk quite a spiritual path as I do, as do I. And so I knew that was something one day needed to have done with that. But in the meantime, the numbers 7 and 9, and we're going to be talking with Karen Dark and Quest 79 and Rachel here a little bit later about those numbers 7 and 9 that are so closely connected to Jenny and so closely connected to Karen Dark. It's like, wow, amazing. But 10th of October, I knew something, but nothing ever came, and I knew it would organically come to the point. And last year, finally, we birthed World Jenny's Day last year. So this is the second World Jenny's Day. And it was fairly international last year, but this year we've really upped it up, and it's got to many more ears. And I say, if it makes a difference to one more person, that's all that matters.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah.
Absolutely. And I think it's really, really important. Now, just for the sake of the people that are listening out there, I've had a couple of messages saying, can we put headphones in to our laptops? Because your phone, it is obviously streaming both. And I think there's a bit of echo going on, Janetta. Would you mind? I've put my headphones on with the advice from Mark. And I think Katanu has actually has organized it. Oh, Mark's just put, yours is sorted, mate. Oh, sorry, mine's sorted. Okay, that's cool. So do we need, just for the sake of Janetta, do we need to sort Janetta out as well, guys? No. Okay, so Janetta, sit down. You're absolutely fine, love. You're absolutely fine, darling. So it was my headphones that are in now. It's all good.
Oh, okay. So I was a good girl. I was behaving myself.
You were behaving yourself.
Very unusual, but okay.
Bless you. So with Jenny's Day, when someone starts a process of changing other people's lives, they don't really, I don't think people really get the full essence of how big an impact they're going to make to someone's life. I know from my experience that, you know, just talking on mental health awareness rooms in Clubhouse alone, I've impacted people's lives from that without even realizing, just telling my story. How was it for you, in the sense that you've kind of started this Jenny's Day, you've obviously been massively affected by what your daughter did, and you've thought to yourself, there's a lot of blame, a lot of, oh my God, why me, all that. You would go through that naturally. Every human being would have to go through that. It's a process. But you came out of it the other side stronger, more able, and certainly determined. And when you were determined to change the outcome of other families going through what you went through, how big was your vision on Jenny's Day? What was your idea about it?
Yeah, the moment, because World Jenny's Day was presented to me by my PR and media people. They came to me and said, why don't you do something really meaningful with this? And I knew I wanted to do something. And I went, this is fantastic. And as they said it to me, I got this whole big picture. It was kind of like far bigger than Jenny and me. Immediately, it just, you know, it kind of downloads from some great
machine infinite power. Intelligence.
Exactly, the grand orderly design, and it went, and I got it. And that it was about building it year by year so that World Jenny's Day became a household name. Right. And it gets out there. People go, 10th of October is not only World Mental Health Day, but it's also World Jenny's Day. And we're talking about building it into a 100-year legacy after today, sitting down and brainstorming, so that I can hand the baton for this and incite the theatrical production and the epiphany process to the next generation. And as I slowly withdraw doing those three, I start speaking and becoming the international mouthpiece. So that's the smaller picture, but the big picture is kind of like how long is a piece of string?
See, that's interesting because I know I'm a very big advocate of charity work. I do a lot of it every year. I produce shows for charity. I perform in charity shows. And I really believe that charities have had a tough time these last year and a half, nearly, 2 years. And one of the things that I think is really important is that if you give purpose behind a charity like yours, and you give a purpose behind what you're trying to do, which is ultimately stopping other people going through what you went through and making them understand how to communicate with one another. When you get that platform, people want to help naturally. I mean, look at me, look at Mark, look at everyone that's on the platform now wanting to help you. If you go to Clubhouse now, it's a plethora of people who have just performed for you, but people who are really up there in their own business that want to support this. Now, this week alone, so today is Sunday, and this week alone, I've been to two charity shows this week, and we've raised over £180,000 for charity this week, simply through performance, auctions, raffles, etc., etc. Do you see yourself getting to a point very, very soon in having a big gala where we can actually talk about your story, bring celebrities and bring influential people to your event, and then grow it from there? And if we did that, what would be your dream goal for that to happen?
Absolutely. It was part of that downloading. I saw celebrities there so that, because my bottom line message is, when you can learn to speak from an open heart, where you're not, because so many of us come from a knee-jerk reaction of fear and judgment. I've got my dog barking at the door. Excuse me. When you come from a place of fear and judgment, and when that happens, those knee-jerk, this was me with Jenny, how dare you talk to me like that? Right. I'm your mother. That's no way to talk to me. Where's this respect? And it's those old ways of learning to react and speak with each other which come from judgment and fear. And they're coping mechanisms we're either taught or we learn from an early age. Now, when you can really, on a conscious and an unconscious level, peel those away and really speak and listen and hear from an open heart. And that is where what I do very, very much shows that and gives people the tools to do that. So I see us being able to have a gala like this with very well-known personalities, understanding that that's the bottom line message worldwide. When you can shift your conversation from fear and judgment into open-hearted understanding and listening. And that will be the theme from year to year to year, because that's all it is. I mean, it sounds, that's all it is. It's tough. But that is the simple, simple happening that takes a lot to make happen. And that's what I see that gala doing.
I find that fascinating. I really do. And I think, with the way you've kind of turned your life around, And I say that in the most unselfish way possible, because it's not about you. It was about your daughter that ultimately, what the experience that happened. But then she left you with it. And selfishly, I think one needs to have that time for themselves. But what you've done is, rather than continue to self kind of abuse yourself in a negative way, which is something that we all do, naturally, we all do that. You've kind of turned it around. Do you know what? I find that fascinating, because I have seen people go through adversities where I know one gentleman in Las Vegas who has become a very close friend of mine. He's a slightly older man. He's in his 70s, but he's a very good friend. And I didn't know his story. And he's picked me up from the airport. And he said to me that his entire family had been killed in a plane crash. And I sat there listening to this guy, and he spoke with such wisdom. And I hear that in you, because he spoke with such wisdom, and it was basically, it is out of our control to a certain degree what the individual goes through. We are all different, and we might have a car accident, a plane crash, this, but we also have our own decisions. I wanted to do this. I had to do this. I felt I needed to do this for myself. We all have those moments. And those decisions can ultimately affect one person or 100 people, or ultimately in a plane crash, hundreds of people. And I just think, how do you take, and this is what I want to do, and then we'll go to a break with Mark, but how do you take what happened to you and start talking to yourself with it? What do you do? What do you say to yourself, Janetta, that ultimately makes you go, right, enough's enough?
Yeah.
What makes you do that?
I just love you've asked that question, because I know a lot of people who meet me, actually there's part of them that go, is Janetta for real? I mean, how can you possibly do what you're doing after what happened? I mean, it's one thing losing a child. It's another one losing a child when you had an argument with them. And that's the thing, is that the process that I worked enabled me to understand that there is a list of loss that's billion miles long. It really, really is there, and it's not going away. So I'm not doing a Pollyanna and going, oh no, everything's fine, because it's not. That right. Loss is there to beyond me. The loss is the loss. You can't change that. It's there. But what the process enabled me to do was start putting together an equally as long list as to what did work in losing her. Now, that's darn difficult to do in the light of day. I mean, everybody's probably sitting here going, really? You mean that? And it's why there's a very special way of getting that balance in through certain questions and applications that finally gets you to twist around so that right. You see equal amount of balance on both. And that's why it's the yin and yang. And when that happens, your unconscious starts accepting and going, okay. So you become very clear and certain and focused and specific, rather than muddled between overthinking and overfeeling, roller coastering, going think. Oh, pain. And that's what distracts you. So when you can bring those into manageability, you start becoming very clear.
Right. That's as straightforward as it comes, Janetta. That's amazing. Now, I know that tons and tons of people are going to watch this and get something for themselves out of this. This is incredible wisdom, but it's also they're golden nuggets, as we all know. And what you're doing, and I hope to be part of this Jenny's Day till, whenever, forever and ever and ever.